My name is Kelly Aruda. I work in the Office of Information Technology. I work mostly on IT policy, some privacy and IT governance issues for the campus. My colleague Patrick Burke is here with me today. Patrick is the coordinator of the Disability and Computing program here on campus, and so he's going to jump in and help clarify or give us some additional tidbits as we go through the presentation. If you have questions, we're going to meet in the hallway afterward so that the next session can keep moving, but we can continue our conversation if we want into the hallway. So my presentation is going to be about 15 minutes, and then I'm going to hand it off to my colleague Chris Patterson, who is also going to talk to you about different aspects of IT accessibility. So agenda for the next 15 minutes, we are going to cover why IT accessibility is important. I'll give you several reasons. And then we're going to jump right into Microsoft Word, and we're going to talk about setting up structure and styles in your document. We're going to talk about adding layering to your document, including alt text for images, use of columns, tables, and links. We'll do a quick recap, and then we'll go ahead and move on to color with Chris Patterson. So why is IT accessibility important? Well, I've come up with three reasons, and you can choose one, or you can choose any one or all three. But one of the important reasons for IT accessibility is that there are laws and policy that regulate what we're doing in this field. So we have the ADA, the Americans with Disabilities Act, and we have the 504 Compliance Office here on campus. And then we also have system-wide and electronic accessibility policy. So I've given you a couple of links to those. If you want to get some information on that stuff, feel free to take pictures, or we'll also have these available afterwards. But another reason to care about IT accessibility, which is probably the reason most of us are here, is that we want to help the community and have people who have impairments or disabilities be able to access documents as smoothly as possible. So you want to take into consideration if someone is blind or low vision, if they have color blindness, deaf, hard of hearing, if they have limited motor skills and they can't use a mouse, that's something to consider, and it could even be a cognitive disability. So if we're thinking about IT accessibility and putting that into our documents, you're going to broaden the scope of your community that can actually access these things. And then lastly, you may think it's important because you want to update your skills. Who doesn't want to be a good digital citizen, right? So if you properly structure your documents, you're going to find that your work becomes more efficient, much more polished, and it's going to be accessible to many more people. So jumping right into style, I work on a Mac, so the screenshots that I've used are from my computer. The PC is very similar, but we'll have some cheat sheets referenced at the very end, so you can access those cheat sheets, and they will have how-tos for PDFs, for Word, and for other things. So in Word, the very first thing we want to talk about is style. And if you take nothing else from today's presentation, that you start using styles in your documents, you've taken a huge step into making things more IT accessible. So when you're in your Word document, I just want to make sure you know where these tools are. If you make sure you're on the Home tab, if you scroll across the ribbon to Style, you'll see there's a little drop-down arrow that gives you a bunch of styles to work with. And then right next to it, there's going to be a little icon that looks like a paper document with a blue circle. Click on that, and you're going to open your Styles palette. And I want you to know where that is and to start using it, okay? Once you've got your text in your document, if you highlight whatever your title is, and you click Title, it's going to format it for you. It's going to do the same thing for your heading 1, 2, 3, for your regular text, your bulleted list. It's going to go ahead and format everything for you. Now, if you decide after formatting that stuff that maybe heading 2 and heading 3 look too similar and you want to differentiate them a little more, you can go ahead into your Styles palette, click on heading 2, and you'll get all the options for heading 2. Maybe you want to increase it by 2 points or make it bold. You can go ahead and do that, and it's going to change all the heading 2s in your entire document for you. So remember when you used to highlight it up at 2 points, highlight the next one up at 2 points? You don't have to do that. You just have to do it once, and you're going to save yourself half an hour. So once you get comfortable with that, and let me just ask, are people using styles today? Is anyone employing styles? Okay, so we're going to start using styles, and then once you get comfortable with that, you're going to jump into adding alt text for your images, okay? So get comfortable with styles, then we're going to start layering other things onto your document. And alt text for styles is so helpful to people who use assistive devices. So again, here I'm on the Mac, and I right-click on my picture, and my picture is selected. I right-click, and I get this menu. I choose Format Picture, then I have all these options to format my picture. I'm going to go to Alt Text at the bottom of this list, and I'm going to get a screen where I can put in a title and a description. And those are two different things. So for my image, I gave it a title of image of the portal fire and a date. And then I've described what this image looks like. Now imagine if this is a line graph or a bar graph, and it's for revenue for the past decade. You might say revenue or line graph or pie chart or something of revenue 2000 to 2010, but here you're going to describe what that chart is saying. So you might say revenues increased for the first half of the decade. They peaked at 2007, dropped, and then plateaued in 2010. Let the person know what is in that picture. Imagine just getting a document where you've got all of these charts and no description. For someone who can't see that, it's a blank document. Okay, so those are the two big things. We're going to go over about three more items that you can go ahead and add to your documents, and then we're going to hand it over to Chris. So this is a super easy one. Use of columns. I know there are people out there that still create columns with tabs and spaces. Find those people and tell them to stop doing that. There's a much easier way. You're going to save a ton of time, and your document's going to be so much better structured. To use tabs and spaces is chaotic, and someone who has an assistive device, I mean, it's almost unmanageable to get through that. So all you have to do is highlight your block of text. Again, go across to your layout, tab, and then across to your icon. Click on it and just choose how many columns you want. So in a few seconds, we'll go from there to there. And you don't have to readjust your entire document because you've used a tab or a space. Super easy. Tables is a topic that could probably use a half hour on its own. But for today, I just want you to know that using tables helps put structure in your document, so it helps assistive devices to read what's happening in the document. But you need to give it some sort of a header so that the screen reader, for instance, knows what the categories are. So the best way to do that today in Word is to go over to the table menu, scroll down to table properties, make sure your header row is highlighted, and once you get to table properties, click on your row tab, and just make sure you click this option here, which says repeat header row at the top of every page. So it's going to let the screen reader know what those headings are. Okay. Links. This is our last piece. Use of links. Now remember, you know how to use styles now, right? So when I want to include a link style, I'm going to highlight it and tell it in the styles palette to be a hyperlink. And I'm going to make it stand out. Here I've used a different color blue. I've underlined it so that there's a lot of contrast. For visual people, I'll be able to scan the page and find it pretty quickly. So I've only done one half of it. I've given it a style so the screen reader knows there's a link here. but we have to go behind the scenes and tell it where to go. So once I've formatted this file, I want to go back and highlight that text and go to Insert, Hyperlink, Command-K on the Mac, and I want to fill out this box. I want to tell it where to go to on the internet. So I can either go to a web page, a document, or an email. So for this example, we're going to go to a website, and we're going to fill in the address of the website and the actual text that I want displayed in red. So I don't need it to read the HTTP address. It can read the text, but I want to make sure that it goes to the right place. And that's going to help the screen reader tremendously. Okay, so just wrap up real quick. A couple of things to keep in mind. Of course, I mentioned styles. Start using your styles and then add to them. Use sufficient contrast. Things like white and yellow, dark blue and black, those don't provide very good contrast for someone who may be low vision, and also people who are colorblind. So keep color in mind when you're choosing a palette. Don't rely just on color to convey your meaning. Like I just said, if someone is colorblind and you've used red text to say this is important, those people are going to miss it completely. So maybe you add an underline or a bold or something other than color to that. Table of contents, we didn't spend any time on it, but if you're doing a lengthy document, think about putting a table of contents, because what will happen is that gives the entire document structure so that the screen reader knows they can scan the entire document just by using the table of contents. If that table of contents isn't there, the screen reader has to go through every line of the document to figure out what you want to read. So put that structure in place. And then
and putting that together with the styles that you've been using. So if you have headings for each section, you can create the table of contents automatically, and it's very simple.
Right. So you can go ahead and scan the document and go through all the heading ones to figure out what you want to focus on. If those styles were not in place, again, the screen reader just reads line by line by line. Right, Patrick?
Yep.
So put your styles in and use that table of contents. And then lastly, think about your audience. Use simple language. We all get caught up in our areas of expertise, and we use jargon, and we use three-letter acronyms all over the place. But think about your audience. If you want to convey the message to a broad range of people, keep it simple, keep it clear. Okay, so here are a couple of resources. These will be available after the techathon. So there's the DCT website. There's a website for a bunch of cheat sheets and a bunch of additional resources from a brown bag we did on campus.
All right, so I'm going to talk about color contrast. And these are used colors from the UCLA brand palette. So the primary rule regarding color contrast is a color contrast level, you need a ratio of 4.5 to 1. So if you compare black to white, your ratio of using black text on a white background or white text on a black background would be 21 to 1, so 21. And so the minimum level for contrast ratios when you're putting colors together is 4.5 to 1 to meet the AA requirement. And then there's an exception, a couple of exceptions here. Logos are exempt. If text has no information, it's purely decoration, then it's not a problem. We go look at the UCLA colors, and I pulled these. We pulled these from the brand guidelines. If you go to brand.ucla.edu, master brand, and then digital and brand colors. So this page has some brand colors on it, and this image is not easy to read, and is inaccessible, it's another matter, but you can download the ASC file, which goes into Adobe Illustrator, or Photoshop, I think. And that's how we got the colors, was we downloaded this and pulled them out of Illustrator. So if we go back to these colors, these are the colors that were in their chart or in their ASC swatch file. And then this last one is another one that they had recommended as a more accessible option than some of these others. So what we're doing here is we're taking each color and putting it on a dark background and a white background. So this is black and this is white, as saturated as you can get, right? For the hex codes, the black is 000, the white is FFF. And we're looking for numbers of 4.5 or above. So for example, a 5.19 is a passing number, right? So if you use this blue on black background, or using black text on this blue background, you would have a ratio of 5.19 to 1. If you use that same blue on a white background, your ratio is only 4.05. So this fails. This is too low. It's below 4.5. So what we've done here is create a chart, you know, to say, you know, where the passing ones are, where the failing ones are. And as you can see, most of these colors, because they're so bright and pass on a dark background, but they do not pass in a white background. So that's something to keep in mind when you're using the UCLA design palette, is most of these colors in this palette are not going to work on a white background, but they will work on dark. There are a few that are opposite, right? So this one works on white, but not black. And this one works on white, but not black. And then this last one has the exact same ratio, whether it's on white or black, 4.58, and it's just barely passing that 4.5, right? Just barely passes in both cases. So those are the kind of the colors. So keep these in mind as you're choosing your colors for your design. And then another thing to consider is that if you use a light color that's not white, these numbers will change. If you use a dark color that's not totally black, these numbers will change. So if you're using a 333 dark gray, you're not going to get the ratios that are this high as when you use black. If you use, you know, a CCC light gray, you're not going to get these numbers either. So keep in mind that, you know, the numbers change based on the colors. And the tool that I'm using to actually pull out these numbers is called Snook Color Contrast Checker. It's by a guy named Jonathan Snook. And the reason, there's lots of color contrast tools out there. The reason I like this one best is it's got these sliders to let me tweak with the color until I find something that's accessible. So this is what I'm using, and this is the key item, WCAG 2 AA compliance. This is the yes you're looking for in this box. AAA level is actually 7:1. That's for enhanced contrast, and you know, we would recommend that for sites that cater to users with disabilities. But for your general sites, the AA compliant level is reasonable and meets our requirements. So we go back here, then the second table here I've got compares the yellows to the blues. So what we see a lot of on UCLA websites is people using yellow on a blue background or blue on a yellow background. So what this says is that basically all of these blues do not work with any of these yellows except this darkest blue works with the yellows. Everything else is below a 4.5. Now, a few of these, the above three, you can use these in, you know, a large heading. An H1, they would work because they're above three, and they would be large enough font to make that work. But for the most part, it's this darker blue that can work with these yellows. So if you're going to use yellow on blue or vice versa, make sure you're passing the color contrast minimum. And I think that's basically all I had.